Matty and Spliff, yeah, for sure. That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
French people have the best taste in all the
two Syrian refugees that came to our house last year and wanted to do something while they waited for the family to come to Denmark. So they started this initiative. So they are an example of what the everyday activism is. This is maybe some of you from August know Skraldekvinden, the dumpster dining cafe.
Yeah.
And Britt is one of the founders, and Stefan is in the background in the grey t-shirt. They were sort of, you know, on social benefits. And with suffers from Asperger's syndrome. Stefan is bipolar, and they just, you know, for years and years they've been sort of living on that government money. Started to go dumpster diving. Does everyone know what I mean when I say dumpster diving? You know, it's in Danish called skralde. Found out while they were doing it that people that they sort of were giving the food to also were lonely and didn't go out. It was like maybe sort of socially challenged single mothers who had with their children and couldn't afford to go out to dinner. So they built this pop-up cafe with old tents and recycled materials from caravans. And now it's like a pop-up food cafe when everybody can come cook. People from the streets, you can come and take part in the cooking, or you can come and just have a meal. This is social health. The Danish health system is really, really big, really, really effective, well-functioning, but still there's a group of people that die 20 years before the Danish average. So they just decided and experienced themselves how hard it was to sort of be in contact with the Danish health system. So they are now using volunteers for health education to be a sort of a mentor or assist when these people have appointments with the health system. These are the three documents that sort of we work from at it's called Sæle Samler in Danish. Use your own life situation as a sort of a background for your initiative. We always do some things at eye level. We work with others, we don't do things for other people. We work sort of from the principle of freedom, and we do things without asking for permission or money. Of course, within the rules and regulations of whatever system that you're in. It's about taking matters into your own hands, and we have seen some really good examples here today already. Inspired from an example, a problem that you feel you have that you can solve yourself, or something that you need, or you think is needed in the system. We co-create with institutions. The activism that we talk about is not sort of in opposition to other things, and it's not confrontational. It's seeks to collaborate and create a dialogue with sort of things around us in the Danish society and worldwide. And it might be a new democratic culture. We see it going on many places in Aarhus, at least in Frederiks and Kolborn, at the South Harbour, in Ghetto, which is like a so-called ghetto in Denmark that is sort of being transformed into something different. And even nationwide and worldwide even. This is where we operate. Sæle Samler, or the House of Everyday Activists, is an organization that is not a part of sort of anything else. We work with the municipality and other institutions, but we are grounded in civil society. We call it a movement of people who act to improve, and these are all everyday activists that we sort of have come to know, and some of them sort of belongs to the House of Everyday Activists, and some exist out in the city, and we're not the only ones. So as a part of Aarhus being the European Capital of Culture next year, we put a bid in 2015 to create a project called Rethink Activism to sort of raise awareness about this movement. So from the 15th to the 17th of September, there's going to be a huge festival down in the South Harbour, maybe something going on here next, around the city, around the whole region of the middle part of Dublin, which is also part of the European Capital of Culture. And you're all very much welcome to come and take part of this and hear more about it. Yes? Alright, so that was it. The end of the slide. We had a really cool Volvo park outside where we drive around and interview people like from 72. what we want to do with this practice is, of course, to tell stories about these everyday activists, which will also be, you know, you hearing their stories today. The project in itself is not actually, like, we don't want to do something on other people's behalf. We just want to meet you and tell your stories, create relation between those different projects, and also meet, invite you to that big festival, and have, you know, just debate: is this a new movement, or is this something that is a glimpse of the present?
This is awesome. I'm going to talk about the trampoline house in Copenhagen later. So it's kind of, maybe you guys have heard of it, maybe not. Then I'll tell you about it.
Trampoline house?
Yeah.
Yes, I think we have.
Yeah. But what my question was, when you showed the dumpster dive kitchen cafe, also I've worked in a lot of kitchens, and I do like these food interventions sometimes. And a lot of times the problem is actually like the health standards, like the Danish, like
The regulations.
Yeah, yes. The regulations. So how do you guys?
Stefan, he's an expert on these regulations.
Okay.
And I'm not sure, because it's not my initiative, but I think it is, because when you cook it on site, like you dumpster dive and you take the food to the site and you cook it together. You're sort of above or outside all these regulations.
So you're like camping, really?
There is something called a bagatellgrenze. So you can have a pop-up events without declaring anything 10 times a year.
But they're working with the municipality, and they are proof when they put up the tent. Like, this is in Mülleparken, which is just...
And also they're not selling, so then that just takes away the whole...
I know, even though you're not selling, I know that you can do the whole donation thing, but I know that you can still... Okay, well, I just wanted to see how you guys do it, because you kind of have to get around...
Yeah, but they contact Alipin, they know, like, it's legit, it's not a...
We just had them for a workshop and talked about it, but they don't even take donations. The way they're working on earning their money right now is by going and doing... food sharing events and taking money for that as a team building exercise or as an alternative experience and selling that to different businesses.
I think actually the municipality of Aarhus has just donated quite a big sum for Skraldecaféen, the Dumpster Diving Cafe, to as like a part of a startup initiative and innovation funding thing.
Well, then maybe you don't know this, but then do they give them like regulations on how they should handle the food once it's taken out of the dumpster?
No. In the moment.
No, it's just like they come. It's really great fun, because you actually have to play with food.
Yeah.
It's like you come in and you walk inside the tent, and there's like a gas stove and a table and a place to do the dishes, and then just these crates with big with
the food
and frozen food and stuff, and you just start cooking something. In
the moment the food hits the dumpster, it's not qualified as food anymore, according to the Food Health Authority.
Okay.
So then they're free, and it doesn't qualify as food, that's why Phil Vastursen doesn't have to.
That's a cool loophole. Yeah.
And I know they have some agreements with their local supermarket, so they're allowed to like
get it before it be through.
And go to the bank and then take it to the cafe.
Also, I know some people that in Copenhagen, they have like the spaces, and they organize workshops with dumpster their food, and how it works is that they take stuff from the dumpster and they write on paper how much stuff, when did they take it out of the dumpster, how much time it took them to get to the place when the workshop is happening, and that's it. And it's by law, it's okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's another question in the back.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, I kind of wanted to comment on what you said there. Do it for others and do it with others and not for others. I wanted to know how you arrived at that, because in Spain there's a whole kind of there's a lot of division between people who are kind of reformist and want to assist people because they feel like they're okay, but they want to help other people. And then there's other people who feel like, no, we're poor and we want to help everybody else, and they never work together. These two kind of aspects of activism. There's always a lot of friction between these things, especially with food recyclers as well.
Yes.
So I wanted to know how you arrived at that, or was there a kind of a struggle to get
it? You can say... There's nothing wrong with either of those two. I think my name wrong is a funny word, but it's because that goes on to many other places, and it's okay not, you know, we it wouldn't happen in our, so it's like a community center really that we have, not really, but like if you want to do something for other people, it's okay, but just go somewhere else to do it. It sounds a bit harsh, but it's really important in our house that it is, like Stefan and Edward with the Dumpster Diving Cafe, that it's their ideas, and even though the municipality now works with them, that they're still the main protagonists, like it's still their decisions, it's still their ideas. And that's why we call them initiatives and not projects, because they just grow in their own time. Like they're not forced to, that's another thing, like some people should have projects for something and then it ends and then it's sort of everything sort of breaks apart.